Gretchen Whitmer, and I'm excited to speak with all of you and our Vice President about abortion rights, and not just in Michigan, but across the nation. And I want to thank the Vice President for joining us, for making Michigan such a priority, for making this fight such a priority. Abortion rights are under attack. Repealing Roe v. Wade was only step one. The coordinated assault on bodily autonomy and family life is ongoing. They've shown us their next steps, a national abortion ban, put health care providers behind bars, ban emergency contraception, ban birth control, ban IVF, as we just saw in Alabama this week, banning mifepristone. This is their playbook. And so while we here in Michigan are very proud that we secured abortion rights in our Constitution, overwhelmingly Michiganders turned out and said we support this right. It should be between a woman and only a woman and her medical provider. And that's why this moment is so important. I'm honored to be introducing a longtime champion in the fight for reproductive rights, someone who has fought for women across the United States as a DA, as an AG, as a senator, and now the first woman in American history to be the Vice President of the United States. So I'm excited to welcome her back to Michigan and introduce her today, our Vice President Kamala Harris.
Thank you, Governor. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Let me start by thanking the Governor. The last time I saw you, we were together at my home, and your leadership in this state and your national leadership has been extraordinary. And you and I have been talking about many issues over the years in our collective fight to secure the rights and the freedoms of the American people. And you and your legislature, the Michigan legislature, have been extraordinary and a real role model for the country about what leadership looks like on this and so many other issues. So it's my honor and pleasure to be with you, Governor. I also want to recognize Senator Stabenow, who I had the great honor of working with in the United States Senate. I think Michigan knows the senator well, but she really is extraordinary. She is such a fighter. I have worked with her. Everybody's laughing because they know her, right? Debbie Stabenow, I'm telling you, whether the cameras are on or whether they're off, she's the same person. She cares so deeply about the working people of America, the women of America, and you've been a dear friend to the president and me, and such a courageous national leader, as well as a leader here in Michigan, Debbie. So thank you. It's great to be with you. And Representative Skolton, today is her birthday. I will not lead the press in singing happy birthday to you. But I want to thank you as well for your courage in the United States Congress and the work you are doing on this and so many other issues. The Congresswoman also, as we were, she honored me by driving in from the airport with me to be here at the church today, Reverend, and made a point of looking out the window and telling me everything that she would like to make sure that we are addressing from Washington, D.C. So she is definitely doing the people's work. And to all the leaders who are here, I thank you, each of you. The administrator, I want to thank you always. Freedom is fundamental to the promise of America. And what we saw over a year ago is the highest court in our land, the United States Supreme Court, the court of Thurgood and RBG, took a constitutional right that had been recognized from the people of America, from the women of America. And since that ruling came down, we have seen states across our country, thankfully not Michigan, but states across our country proposing and passing laws that criminalize doctors and nurses, some provide for prison for life, for healthcare professionals providing reproductive care to their patients. We have seen laws being passed that make no exception even for rape and incest, which means these so-called leaders who are extremists are telling a survivor of a crime of violence to someone's body, a survivor of a violation to their body, that they, that survivor, have no right to make a decision about what happens to their body next, which in my opinion is immoral. We know that on this issue, the American people, the majority of American people agree with the leaders at this table, by the way, which is that one does not have to give up or in any way abandon their faith or deeply held beliefs to agree the government should not be telling her what to do with her body. If she chooses, she will consult with her priest, her pastor, her rabbi, her imam, but it should not be the government telling people what to do with their bodies. And what we have seen on this issue is over the course of now a year and almost a half, people who are suffering every day in our country as a result of this. So not only is it about freedoms that have been taken and what that means in a country that prides itself on being a democracy that upholds and fights for freedoms and liberty, it means that in states across our country, people have been suffering, and we must be explicit about what that is, because this is not a hypothetical point. Women have been having miscarriages in toilets in our country, have been denied access to emergency care because of what has been happening, and then, as the governor said most recently, putting access to IVF at risk. Think about that. Individuals, couples who want to start a family are now being deprived of access to what can help them start a family. So on the one hand, the proponents are saying that an individual doesn't have a right to end an unwanted pregnancy, and on the other hand, the individual does not have a right to start a family. And the hypocrisy abounds on this issue when you also consider that in the top 10 states with maternal mortality, there are abortion bans. I have often challenged the folks in those states who propose to say that an abortion ban is in the best interest of women and children. Ask them, why have they been so silent on an issue like maternal mortality? Where in our country, black women are 3 to 4 times more likely to die in connection with childbirth than other women. Native women, twice as likely. Women in rural America, similarly, more likely. So this is an issue that is about fundamental freedoms and liberty. And it is an issue about harm, real harm that is happening to people every day in our country. And one must then ask, well, okay, how did this happen? And I would say, ask who's to blame. And I'll answer that question. When you look at the fact that the previous president of the United States was clear in his intention to hand-pick 3 Supreme Court justices who would overturn the protections of Roe v. Wade, and he did it. And that's what got us to this point today. And that same individual, the previous president of the United States, then openly talks about how he is proud of what has resulted. Proud of the fact that doctors and nurses can be jailed for giving reproductive care. Proud of the fact that women are being forced into situations where they could literally, their life is at stake in terms of having a miscarriage and not being able to have the medically required treatment. Proud of the fact that so many young women in America now have fewer rights than their mothers and grandmothers. So this is a very real issue, and I thank again the governor and the Michigan legislature for all you have done. But do understand, the people of Michigan cannot sit back and take comfort without also understanding that elections matter and that there is a full-on concerted effort to pass a national ban, which would mean the people of Michigan would not be as safe. And so let's understand the connection between all of these issues and the responsibility and the role that we each have to protect these fundamental freedoms and the people of America to be able to make decisions about their own lives and the future of their family. And with that, I want to thank everyone again, and I'm going to turn it over to Representative Skolton to moderate our discussion.
Thank you so much, Madam Vice President. As a person of deep faith myself, as the first woman and mother in West Michigan history to represent us in Congress, I can tell you, even though we have come so far in Michigan, women like me are still terrified about what might happen. And that's why I every day am working to make sure that we have constitutional protections over these rights and over these freedoms. Even as much as the work that I'm doing here in West Michigan is groundbreaking, we all stand on the shoulders of giants. And there is no taller giant in Michigan than Senator Debbie Stabenow and the work that she has done to champion women and protect our freedoms. And we want to give her a moment to say a few words as well.
Well, thank you. I love saying Congresswoman. I love that. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
And welcome back to West Michigan, my dear friend. I have to tell you, it was so wonderful working with Senator Kamala Harris, and as a partner, as a friend, as an ally, fighting the good fight in the Senate, and then to see you step into the vice presidency role made me so proud, so proud. And I have to tell you that whenever I see the vice president sitting in the chair up front, I know we have the votes to pass whatever we're going to pass. I feel so confident. All these judges that we've been able to pass together.
That's
really
right.
And so thank you. And of course, thank you to the governor and your advocacy, your strength, your leadership on these issues as well as so many issues. And it is not by accident that the governor was able to repeal a lot of anti-abortion, anti-healthcare measures. It's because of a Democratic Senate and a Democratic House, the first trifecta in 40 years. Yeah. So it does make a difference who we are electing. And thank you, Administrator, for being here. And I also have to say, Reverend Rowe, always great to be at Fountain Street. Just 1 minute to emphasize, I think, where we are. We thought we had it done, right? Because people work so hard, everybody worked so hard, passing the change to our Constitution, all the people on the street, getting the signatures for the ballot proposals, working so hard, standing up for our basic freedoms, standing at the polls till well after 8 p.m. on election night. We did it. We got it in the state constitution, protecting our freedom. We passed a great governor and legislative body that would cement that for us. And then we turn around and realize that literally all of this can be stripped away, which with a national abortion ban, which they are trying to do at every level. The majority of abortions in the first several weeks of a pregnancy are mifepristone. And if that medicine goes away, then that's an abortion ban. I mean, everything that's being talked about here is related to getting a national abortion ban, not trusting women. I love your signs. Not trusting women. Any person who can get pregnant is not trusted in this process at all. And so we have to do it again. That's why we're here. We did it, and we have to do it again and make sure that we do not see our freedom stripped away in Michigan or any other state. So I want to turn it to somebody who has been a leader in that fight, who's on the front lines, who can tell us about all those signatures that got signed and all the efforts to put this into our state constitution. I'm sure some of you feel like, oh my gosh, didn't we do this already? But I want to turn it over to the executive director of Michigan Voices, Summer Foster.
Thank you so much, Senator. It is an honor to be here with all of you today. My name is Summer Foster. I'm the executive director of Michigan Voices. Michigan Voices is a progressive nonprofit organization that works to educate, engage, and activate and protect underrepresented and marginalized communities. In 2020, We became concerned that the Supreme Court was going to overturn Roe, and we knew that we needed folks to be aligned on the pathway forward. There were many pathways that we could take. We could do it through the legislature. We could do it through the judiciary, but we really felt like a constitutional amendment was the most durable way to protect our rights here in Michigan. And so we launched the Reproductive Freedom for All ballot initiative in Michigan in January of 2021. We had nearly 60 partner organizations engaged at the beginning of the ballot initiative from every part of our progressive movement. We purposely centered the voices of the most of the people that would be most deeply impacted by the loss of care. And we were able to get the ballot initiative on the ballot and collect over 750,000 signatures in July of 2022. And when the leak happened, we had 30,000 people sign up to volunteer for our campaign. We had folks from every corner of the state reaching out to make sure that they could get petitions to sign them. I remember one day we had a signing event at a coffee shop in Canton, Michigan, and an 18-year-old showed up and they desperately wanted to sign the petition, but they were not registered to vote yet. So they took out their phone and registered to vote on the spot to make sure that they could sign the petition. We heard stories from doctors who were deeply concerned about their patients, from mothers who were so angry that their kids were going to live in a country where they had fewer rights than they had growing up, and for young people who were really afraid of their future. In the end, the ballot initiative passed. Overwhelmingly, Michiganders said that they wanted to protect reproductive freedom in Michigan and secure the legal right to abortion, but we know that those rights are still at risk because we know that there are politicians and judges on a national level who want to take those rights away from us, the rights that we in Michigan fought so hard to keep. And so we stand ready for that fight, and we're so glad that we have champions to stand with us.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Summer. We look forward to continuing the conversation, but this does conclude our press portion of the dialogue. So we'll ask the press to leave the room, and we'll continue the off-the-record conversation.
Thank you so much, guys. You good?
Yeah, thanks so much.